Welcome to the Women of Voice of Faith Evangelical Ministries. Join Rev.Yaw Sarpong with his interactive teachings. Took it from TV UK as the religion.
Important that we share the communion table together with the Lord in that special day. And I welcome all of you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit with our service. I can see the faces of visitation. My dear sister Monica is here to say hello in the presence of the Lord, our dear sister in the Lord. Hallelujah. God bless all of you. It has been a very great attention to give the earnest expectation to the Lord, because this is the time that we seek the face of God. In this present time, there are so many talks and so many difficulties and confusion in the Christendom. So we, the believers, have to be so careful in what we hear and what we see and what we think. These are the areas that in these last days many people will depart from the faith. But manos you in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Please, it has been in my own intention by the power of the Holy Spirit to speak about one of the controversial messages which have been for eons of ages that pastors and ministers and church people have not been able to come to the final conclusion of that. And I have spoken and prayed unto the Lord that the Lord have given me his own views about what he feels for me to come and share with you. So today I would like to speak about the subject which I have entitled The Eternal Security of the Believer. The Eternal Security of the Believer. You may ask yourself, what is that eternal security of the believer? It means that a believer must have eternal security, meaning that you possess the eternal life, and therefore there is no hope of anywhere for you to be lost. And the question I pose to each and every one of you today is to think about yourself. I don't know about your view, but the question that arises in the preparation of the message comes up that I may ask you, that can a believer lost? Can a Christian, a believer, someone who is in Christ Jesus, can he fall lost or lost his salvation? You may be hearing a lot of preaching about this subject, that if you do wrong things or you don't serve the Lord properly, you will not go to heaven. And some people preach these messages as if they own heaven. And I have come with an objection about the truth, what the scripture says and what the scripture hasn't says, that people shouldn't put it together. We are called upon by God to study and to approve ourselves a workman that needed not to be ashamed, but rightly in dividing the word of truth. But the word of truth have been divided into a different kinds of categories, and it has affected many Christians. So many people are confused. Some are very feared. They thought they would lose heaven. Some have left the Christendom. Some don't want to know again, simply because of the teachings that they have heard about our heaven. But today, the Spirit of God is broken through my mouth unto you that you carry eternal life. So you have eternal security. Praise the Lord. And I want us to open our Bible to the book of Romans chapter 8, verse 38 to 39. Romans 8, verse 38 to 39, for us to see what the Spirit of God wants to take us through this subject. And it will help you to stand very firm in your Christian faith. And it will also advise you that you will look at your foundations if it comes to a point that you don't see yourself in what the Spirit of God is requiring. Hallelujah. Romans chapter 8, verse 38 to 39. And the word of the Lord says, for I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor power, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor power, nor things present to come, or nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus. That means once a sinner places his life into Christ Jesus and be saved, justified, that person is eternally secured. And the Bible said nothing can separate you from the love of Christ. Nothing can separate you. He has mentioned a lot of things over here, which everything that we thought that we can be separated of, the fear, the anxiety, all those have been mentioned, and he says none of them can separate you from the love of Christ. And here we're talking about eternal security. And can a believer lost, can you lost your soul in salvation? This is what he's talking about. And the strength and the energy in your heart will determine that what you feel inside you. I don't know what you feel inside you about your own self with your Christian faith. And this has made many people, the way they approach the Christianity is in a different way, because they have not thought to possess the eternal life. And they are not enjoying the privilege of the eternal security of their Christian life. So we live in a life where many are not serious. And you look at some of them, you don't understand. But here the Spirit of God says that there is nothing that can separate you from the love of Christ. He said it's either death nor life. So even if we are dying, we fear not. Nothing can separate us. Sicknesses cannot separate. Poverty cannot separate. He said death nor height. There is everything, or even things to come. We all fear unknown. So many of us fear the future. He said that cannot separate us. There is nothing on this earth that can separate you when you give your life to Christ Jesus. So calling to a believer is very, very important, that the believer have got eternal security, eternal possession, that you are going to heaven. No matter how you live your life, it is about you being seen in Christ that you are going to heaven. This will move you. This will automatically come out of your mind and the practical aspect of it and what you do for the Lord. Praise him. So we see that he said no power, no sin, unseen power or seen power can separate us. And there is nothing that is good or bad in this world, either angels or principalities, none of them, the demons, the witches, the all the forces that they chase us, they every time looking for you for your destruction. He said none of them can separate you from the love of Christ. So it is absolutely very important. It is the same way that you must have your confidence that you are sealed in Christ Jesus. So the Holy Spirit have confirmed for you and I, and it is very important for we to walk in the newness of life, because we possess the new life, the new creation, and we are sealed in Christ. So nothing can separate us. Nothing can separate us. There are so many questions that arises in such a topic. That what about if a Christian, some are pastors, some are ministers, some are elders, they have done a great things in the kingdom, and what about if they walk away? How did that affect these teachings that we teach? Many people have deceived many. Many are doing great things in the kingdom. Many are building the houses. Many are doing so many things. And the Spirit of God is taking us through to answer these questions whilst we are going through, because it will help us to understand the way we will approach the Christian life. There have been a lot of messages that warn you and I that we have to try and do a lot of things. But it is not about you and I. It is about God doing His own thing in our life. If we try to do anything aside from the truth of what God is saying, that means the salvation or the justification which God has brought to us, it means that we can help ourselves. If we could help ourselves, then Jesus would have not come. So there is nothing that we must do to help ourselves except we place our heart, our mind in the hands of God, and God will take us through to the end of our life. Praise Him. So the Lord Jesus in His days found some way to speak to us. Let us open our Bible to the book of Matthew chapter 7 verse 21. If we talk about eternal security, what we don't mean about eternal security is that it does not mean that if somebody just come to church and come to the front, an altar called, and come and shake the preacher hand and become a member and be baptized, means that that person is eternally secured. It does not mean that when men of God or people who have got ministry, like myself, preaching and doing wonders, signs and wonders in the Lord, does not mean that we have eternally secured. It does not mean that when people come to church and become members of the church and they do everything in the church, does not mean that they are eternally secured. Now, the Bible says to us, as the Lord Jesus Himself gave us a word in His days, in Matthew chapter 7 verse 21 to 23, and He says that, "Not everyone that said unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name? And in thy name have cast out devils, and in thy name done many wonderful works, and in thy name, or then I will profess unto them, I never knew you, depart from me, ye that work iniquity." Now, if you read this passage, you could see that though the Lord is talking about, they have done many great things in the house of God. They are doing commendable things. They are doing signs and wonders. Some are casting out demons. Many people have got their healings under their administration. But the Lord says in the last day that, "I know you not." He didn't say, I knew you and you have forfeited my glory or my grace, so I knew you not. He said, "I know you not completely." He did not know them. Because of all what they have done, they now cry that, "Lord, we have built the houses, we have done so many great things, we cast out demons, we healed the sick, we set the captive free, we give to the poor." And He said, "Yet I don't know you." The only people that He recommend to be in the kingdom is those who do the Father's work. He said, "Not everyone that said unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have you not prophesied in thy name? And in thy name have cast out devils, and in thy name done many wonderful works. And then will I profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity." Then he move on. Let's see another scripture. You may remember in the book of John chapter 10, verse 27, 30. We're going to go through a lot of series of scriptures today because we are trying to come up to a point of proving a better doctrine that will move our hope to the higher level. John chapter 10. The Lord mentioned over there, "My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me, and I gave unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish, neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. My Father, which gave them me, is greater than all, and no man is able to pluck them out of my Father's hand. I and my Father are one. Can a Christian ever lose a soul? He said, my sheep hear my voice. That is his. My sheep hear my voice. And I know them. He knows them. The Lord knows you who are his. And he knows those who are not his. So when the day comes and people are screaming, Lord, Lord, he knows his already. Those he don't know, he said, I know you not. But the one he knows are those who hear his voice. And they follow him. And these people were not given, they were given to him by his Father. You were chosen in Christ Jesus by his Father. Before the foundation of the world, that is the work of God on your behalf. And God begin a good job in you, which surely he has accepted you in heaven. And he is bringing that to pass. So his Spirit is taking control of you from the very day you were converted. The Holy Spirit take control to convert you and to conform you to the image of Christ. So he doesn't leave you. So can a believer lost? A believer can never lost. The Bible says that he will not perish. He said, I will give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. Neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. I'll bring this passage also to the end as well, because this is the most crucial part of the passages that raise an objection that you cannot lose your eternal life. So you have to build yourself according to your hope. You must hope that and be proud of yourself that being a Christian, you possess eternal life. Eternal life is in your hands. And so you do what it takes for you to live a life as somebody who have eternal life. Don't be fearful of anything. Don't be fearful of death. Don't be fearful of the condition of this life. Don't be fearful of what is going on around the world, because that cannot separate you from the love of God. You carry eternal life, and you must be bold. Anyone who knows this in his own spirit and soul and heart, they are bold. They walk majestically. They are proud to be somebody possessing eternal life. They are not miserable. The world means nothing to them. The kingdom of God is their business. The law of God is their life. They make Christianity as business. Religion is their business. They live in them. They are obedient to the faith. They are obedient to the word. And the testimony that are inside such people who possess eternal life, as the Bible talk about the assurance of their salvation, they have the means of their assurance. The testimony of the word of God is inside their heart. And the testimony of the Holy Spirit is inside them. That is the inner witness inside them. And the testimony of their conscience bear witness that they are Christian. And the testimony of their life, the Christian life, their life is in line with the word of God. Let's not take our eyes off from anything except we are doing the Father's will. If we try to go around anyway, the Lord says, I would not know you. And so we have to be very careful. There are a lot of teachings that goes around and tell many of us that if you become a converted believer, and you don't do this and that, or you don't live a perfect life, or you don't try to live holy life, you will lose your salvation. So many people try an effort and try to do things, to do everything, to live their life to the rest of the end, or to the end of salvation. And yet they can't, because your strength can never. You don't understand the purpose of God. You don't know how God prepared this salvation unto you. You don't know about the redemptive work of God. And so we try and fail. And many have gone and come back. They fail and confess. They fail and confess. They fail and confess. And some have lost the faith, because they come to a point that they see that they cannot help it. But the teachings of their life have made that be so. They think that their works will be able to help them to go to heaven. And most of us have in mind, as myself, I had in my mind, that the very time I was converted, I thought all my sins from the past of my sins have been forgiven. And God has given me a chance now from this time that I've been converted, from the day one, to live a godly life, a holy life, until the end of my life. Then I will go to heaven. And as a Christian, I still fall short into sin every time. I struggled with this up to about 5 years in my Christian life. I could not do things right. I could not change my life. I could not transform by the renewal of my mind. I could not do what the Bible tells me to do. My obedience was in trouble. But it came to a point where the Spirit of God take control of my life and brought to me the truth about this teaching, that it is not about what I do. It is about the sovereignty of God and the human responsibility. The problem is that the area of realization of the atonement work of Christ. When I say realization of the atonement work of Christ, it's when you realizing what God have done in Christ Jesus and you have to apply to it. The sovereignty of God and the human responsibility. What God have done in Christ Jesus, man must apply to his life. This is the problem. And our responsibility is not to continue the work that God is doing for us. But the teachings which I heard, and I live with it myself before, is that we are continuing with our works. So they now pronounce that faith without work is impotent. That means if I have faith, I have to work hard of my salvation. And there's a scripture that goes with it, that work hard for your salvation with trembling. It does not mean I have to work hard on my salvation. So we take it personally, we take it that we are to work with our salvation and help God to bring his work to pass. But the Spirit of God said, no, you cannot help God in salvation. You cannot help God in his redemptive work. So we have been struggling and many have lost the faith because they have tried everything. Some people will come to the Lord with addiction and they try everything to stop it by themselves with their effort, with their strength. And they go back on it and go back on it and come back and repent, confess themselves and repent again and repent again. They make it look like as if when we hear the word in the Bible that says that ye must be born again, as if the word is saying that you must be born again and again and again and again. That is the misinterpretation of the word of God. There's no teaching in the Bible that says we must be born again and again and again and again. There's no teaching like that. The very moment you converted yourself, the very moment you accepted what God have done in Christ Jesus, the very moment you believe, your responsibility is to believe. Just acquiesce. It is freely given to you. Your responsibility is the application, that just believe what God is telling you, and he will now take you and do all by his Spirit. But many have taken it on their own work. But in the balancing of these two streams, that says that the sovereignty of God, the work that God have done for us in Christ, and then our responsibility, These two things have to be balanced. If what God have done for me, if I accept that in Christ Jesus, then automatically there is a provisions, there is a privileges attached to what God have done. He has done everything in Christ. And so the moment I believe that, the moment I give my life in, and that moment, all the privileges with the Holy Spirit, the manifestation, the Spirit will bear witness with my spirit, and the Spirit will begin to use my members for the instruments of righteousness. The Spirit will begin his own work. He will begin to conform me, will begin to direct your path, will begin to change every aspect of your being in the likeness to Christ. So there is a work to be done with you, and God continue his work. But we have taken it on our own, that when we become converted, we have to also live a holy life. And many have been struggled till today. But when we overemphasize our work makes us become a legalistic Christians. So there are many Christians who are legalistic people. They live their life as a their legalism. It is about their works, what they can do. They think they can go to heaven because of what they do. And so they are proud about their works. They are building self-righteous life for themselves. And these people, they give up. They're not born again. And some have get confused. They don't understand. But when we also take advantage that because I have eternal security, the Bible has said so, therefore I will not perish and I will not do anything for the Lord. I will just sit down and do what I want. When you overemphasize the sovereignty of God too, you become also fatalism. You begin to sit down and thinking that you are fine, but you are not fine. You have not been regenerated yet. So the balancing of these two extremes, God and man meeting together with the work of Christ, that is a big problem that many people have lost. That's the big problem that many are not born again. That's the big problem that many think they are born again, but they are not regenerated. And the teaching goes on and on. And some are legalistic in themselves. They don't even know the saving grace of Jesus Christ. The privileges, they don't even know. And they're using their strength. And some have been fed up. Some have died and gone. And they are lost. So he said, it's not anyone that said, Lord, Lord. And he also said, my sheep hear my voice. Do you hear the voice of the Lord? It is that you can say to yourself that you have the assurance of salvation. You have the security in you. The security that must be in you that depends on your hope. That security will say to you that you have a knowledge that God has forgiven you. And you are surely, we have confidence that God has forgiven you completely. So there's no doubt. I want to take the doubt of many believers' mind. The doubt of this area make people not be serious. It's either they overemphasize the manward side of the atonement, or they overemphasize that, oh, I am a Christian. Because I'm a Christian, I don't need to do anything, just that I'm going to heaven. So they are very proud of going to heaven. It is not for all. It is those who hear the voice of the Lord, those who follow the Lord. The Lord is the same word that was given to us. He is the word that God gave to us. God has spoken to us in Christ. He is the voice of God. And if we are to follow him, that means we follow the voice of God. And the voice of God is what we carry, the written word. He is the Rhema. And so he said, my sheep hear my voice and they follow me. And what he said he will give to them? I will give to them eternal life. And he continued to say, they will do what? They will not perish. They will never perish. And he continued to say in John chapter 3 verse 16, he said what? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have eternal life or everlasting life. A believer cannot perish. A Christian cannot perish. But who is that Christian who will not perish? The one who hear the voice of the Lord. The one who follow the Lord. The one who do the will of the Father. And this is not by your strength. It comes by automatically. So it's time for people to look through their repentance and check themselves. Because some of us approach the doctrine of repentance, or some of us approach the repentance in a different way. Many of us are spiritually disabled as a result of repentance. Many of us have abused what repentance is, and they have faked it. So when it comes to the truth, when it comes to those who are going to heaven, when it comes to those who are for the Lord, when it comes to the sheep of the Lord, there is a very, very line that are drawn around it. They hear the voice of the Lord. You may say, how do I hear the voice of the Lord? It is automatically. You do things that the Lord says to do. You follow what is in the Bible. You automatically love the Lord. You automatically love the word of God. You automatically have a conscience that tells you what is right and wrong. You do all these things without any struggling. If you see yourself struggling in this, that means some of you are still a baby Christians. They must grow by reading the word. You are called. You have eternal life. You possess it. But how do you live with it? It's not by your works. The eternal security of the believer. Now you talk about a place where suppose somebody become a Christian and they left. What do you put it? The word of the Lord says in 1 John chapter 2 verse 19, it says that they went out from us, but they were not of us. If they had been of us, they would no doubt have continued with us. But they went out that they might be made manifest that they were not all of us. Or literally, that they were not all together of us. You see, many come to the church and they walk away. It's not that they are Christian. They are not part of the Christendom. Those who backslide and walk away, or they apostatize, the Bible said they are not of us. If they are of us, they will continue. So if you live this Christian life and you gave up, it's not about the problem you are complaining that make you give up. You have not regenerated. You are not of the calling ones. You are not of the chosen ones. If you are the chosen one, you will endure to the end. And that perseverance or the endurance is not about your strength. Many speak about the perseverance of the saint. The perseverance of the saint is not about the saint. The work that we are living in, going to heaven, is not anything about ourselves. It is about God doing his work. When we begin to have this confidence, the enemies, the demons, the witchcraft, the forces, the spiritual, the spirit of darkness, they will flee away from you. They will not be comfortable with you. Because the Bible says, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. The freedom you carry is the confidence and the assurance of your security that you have. And sometimes you can tell, as the Bible says, we don't even die. The Lord have come, gone down to the grave and saved you and I. One of the greatest things that we have to, or we have not realized, is that when Adam, who is the first Adam, the first Adam is Adam, and the second Adam is Jesus Christ. Now, all of us here, when we were born into sin. You may say that all those things that happen I wasn't part of it. It was not me. Yes, it wasn't you. You may say that it was not any of my sin, the act of my sin, that brought all these things, that brought the death. Yes, it's not of you. But the whole of us, all of us, we were in Adam. Adam represent us. We were being represented by Adam, and when Adam failed, all of us failed. So Adam failed, and all of us failed, as the Bible talk about in the book of Hebrew, that one of the children of Levi, was inside Abraham when Abraham met Melchizedek. And Abraham submitted tithe to Melchizedek. The Bible says that Levi was inside Abraham's loins, so Levi paid tithe. So the same representation, we too were in Adam, when Adam represented the human race and Adam fall. So each and every one of us, none of us were born up here. We are all born down there. What is down there? Down there is in the grave. You will say, Pastor, I'm still living. How was I born down there? I was born alive and I'm talking. Every one of you, because Adam has already, where is Adam? Adam was in the grave. When he sinned against the Lord, he was dead. And he died and went to the grave to meet death. Death capture every human being. Because we are all born down by Adam. And so either you live or not, you were captured by death, spiritually speaking. Even the time that happened, we were not born, but yet you will die and go to the grave and the death will capture you. So the second Adam, the Lord Jesus came. He was born up here, like the way Adam was born. Adam was created up here. And he was created sinless, but he sinned. And he died. And he went down. But the Lord Jesus was conceived with the Holy Spirit, with the Virgin Mary. And he was born alive up here. And he came in to save us. And on the cross, he went down to where death is. And then fight against death and set all us free. And when he was triumphant coming up, he came up not alone. He came up with all of us. He came up with Adam. He came up with Abraham. He came up with all those who were captive. Our forefathers, they died in sin. And the Lord came in and he paid the price. And the price he paid, he set all of them free. And that freedom he set them have set all of us free. So if you die now, death have not got any hold of you anymore. When you finish this world, now you go asleep, but you still live. The Bible says, even though you die, but you live. Why? Because you have eternal life. And that must be a security in your heart as a believer. Praise him. So when we talk about the eternal security, we base on some scriptural truth or scriptural testimonies. The importance of those scriptures that will help us to understand fully what is the eternal security of the believer. Now let's open our Bible to the book of Hebrews. Hebrews chapter 10. So the first point we're talking about is the perfection of Christ's offering upon the cross. The number one point of the scriptural testimony is Christ's one offering. We are talking about eternal security. Hebrews chapter 10. Hebrews 10. Hebrews chapter 10. From verse 11 to 18. Praise him. The Bible says, and every priest stand ministering daily and offering repeatedly the same sacrifice which can never take away sins. But this man, after he had offered one sacrifice for sin forever, sat down at the right hand of God, and from that time waiting till his enemies are made footstool. For by one offering, verse 14 is the importance, for by one offering he has perfected forever those who are being sanctified. But the Holy Spirit also witnessed to us, for after he had said before, this is the covenant that I will make with them after those days, says the Lord, I will put my laws in their heart, and in their mind I will write them. Then he adds their sins and their lawless I will remember no more. Now, where there is remission of these, there is no longer an offering for sin. So the Lord perfected once and for all. He perfected us once and for all. So the Bible says that the perfect view of his sacrifice is to perfect us. So we are perfect in the sacrifice of Christ, if we are in Christ. So he said, the Lord Jesus Christ, he gave his life, and the whole of the book of Hebrew, which many people have not realized. And I wonder why we read this and still teaching some teachings as if we have to work for our own salvation. The book of Hebrew is talking to us in contrasting of the sacrifices of the law and the sacrifices of Christ. That on the law, when anybody sin and goes to the temple, they go with a sacrifice of sin. And every year, the whole nation will go into the presence of the Lord with a sacrifice. And they continue to eat every time and time and time. Why? Because the offering which they were doing cannot take away sin. It can't take away sin. It just only covers the surface, and yet the people have to continue to come back and do it again. But the Bible says that in verse 14, it said, the Lord Jesus Christ, for by one he had perfected forever them that are sanctified. Who are them that are sanctified? You as a believer, you are set apart unto God. You are sanctified. The sanctification means the work of God, the Spirit. That is the work of the Holy Spirit. You are sanctified. That means there is a work that the Spirit of God is doing with you. Say, for by one offering he had perfected forever them that are sanctified. Perfected for how long? Perfected forever. Because the sacrifice is what? It's efficacious. Christ's one sacrifice remit all our sins forever. And somebody will say, it covers my sin for how long? Some are saying that, is it for my past sins and now I've been given a chance to live and live on my own righteous? It's like a sieve that when God saves us, he brings us to be like in covering Adam and put us in the place of Adam and say, now live your life. That is how many teachings are going on to be. God save you and I and bring us to the position of Adam, to this world, and say, now live, don't die. Is that what eternal life is for? That is not the way God the Father do to us. He saved us, and now he put us even higher because of the divine grace. Grace divine. He made us, put us higher. Where is the higher position we are? We are sitting on the right hand side of the Father. Our life is hidden in Christ Jesus. So this secure our position. Because the one who stands for us, Christ Jesus, is the one who stands for us. He is our mediator. As Adam was our mediator, and Adam died, he sinned, and he died, we all died. And now Christ Jesus also is our mediator. As he lives, you will live. And where he is where we are. If he fall, we are all falling. But if he is living, we are living. And how can the Lord Jesus fall? Praise him. Many people deny that. They don't talk about this sacrifice. And if we don't talk about this sacrifice, we bring the sacrifice of Jesus Christ to the level of the Old Testament sacrifice. The legalistic Christians bring the sacrifice to the level, to the lower part, and then it falls like the Old Testament sacrifice. And that is what have failed many Christian lives. Praise him. So we need to understand certain things that will make us have the eternal security. Your security will make you walk the way you walk as a believer. Your assurance, that is your hope you carry. One of the things that we must realize is that God save us and give that eternal life into that dead body. And as the body is dying, we are waiting for our own redemptive body. And waiting for the redemptive body, every time we are seeking for, we are hoping for, eternal life. So we hope for eternal life. And by hoping for eternal life, we walk as someone who possesses eternal life. Not the one who thinks every time, if I sin, I have to go back and confess. They have relegated the born again as if born again and again and again. And they have also brought the sacrifice of Jesus Christ, one perfect sacrifice. They have made it and relegated it as if it is equivalent to the Old Testament sacrifice. The Old Testament sacrifice could not take away sin. It was an offering. But the sacrifice of Christ Jesus perfected us all once and for all. He made all of us perfect. Not to any extent. He perfected all of us who are sanctified. And so that sacrifice sealed you that you carry eternal life. It is not about you going back and do it again. So many of you have to understand certain principle as a believer. Now a Christian, when you convert your life to God, the very first time you convert your life to God, the relationship between you and God as a judge and somebody as a sinner has already been canceled. Now you fall into another relationship, as a relationship of a father and a child. Now when you sin again, which we normally do, we don't say we don't sin. When you sin again, now you don't stand in front of God as judge anymore. You stand in front of God as a child. And God is going to discipline you as a father or a mother or a parent discipline their child. So we must now realize that we have been chosen and now we have been led by the Spirit of God as sons and daughters of God in the house of God. So we are already with God. Eternal life means your mind is always up there. So we are taught to seek our affections, set our affections on things above. That is the only way we can live this eternal life. And this is where we live and left all our enemies behind. If not, you'll be tormented by evil forces. You'll be tormented by demons. You'll be tormented by witchcraft. You'll be tormented by what the devil is doing. And stop thinking about the work of Christ on your behalf. The sovereignty of God and human responsibility. What God has done in Christ, man must apply to it. Your application doesn't give you any strength on your own to do, which many of us have done many things with our life. We try to think our strength can make us live holy life. And we've done that for many years. I myself did it. And every time I fall into sin again, as a Christian, I can't help it. I lied. If I got a chance, I would steal. And I struggled with that 5 years of myself. Because every time when I do that, the next Sunday I will go to church and confess. And the teaching is that, one day if you couldn't come and confess and you die, you go to hell. It's a very common teaching around everywhere. But when I grew up when I was touched by the Holy Spirit, when I assessed my repentance, when I assessed where I come from, I realized that my foundation was wrong. I have not offered my body as a living sacrifice unto the Lord, and therefore I struggle to let the Spirit of God take control of me and use me. And I'm doing things with my flesh. And the flesh, there's nothing per se in the flesh except the sinful deeds. So my deeds were still evil. I have not put on the new man. So the old man, which was in sin, which was in death, that is the same nature which I carry. And as a Christian, so the old nature still go on and sin. And I struggle to understand myself. The things that I want to do, I cannot do them. But the things that I don't want to do, that is the things I do. That means there is a nature inside me that is enmity against God. And that nature every time suppress me from the presence of God and make me become a little, make me become somebody who cannot have authority and power inside me. And that nature send me straight to demons and witches and demons and fear. And every time my life is tormented by fear, haunted by satanic invasion, which it shouldn't be. My life is supposed to be captured and placed in Christ before the foundation of the world. That is the truth about my nature. And I was placed into Christ. And the very first time I was converted, the Spirit of God baptized me in the body of Christ as a reality. And I was sealed in the body. Sealed to not any extent, not any limit. I was sealed in the body completely until the day of redemption. Until I receive my body. And so I was told and teach in the Bible to understand myself that now if I have this inside my mind, then the life that I must live is to seek things above. Because why? My life is hidden in Christ Jesus and is sitting on the right hand side of the Father. And that brought me close to the holiest of holies of God. And that place, demons cannot go there. Witches cannot go there. And it was that time when I realized myself, when I speak to witches, they move. Then I said, my God, there is a power in the name of Jesus. Because I have come to take control, full possession of my being. As a powerful child of God. With authority, the omnipotent, the omniscient. Unless we realize this, we cannot rule the world. We are to control the world. We are to silence all the things that are going on in this world. We are the salt of the world. We are the light of the world. But do we light up? Because we have been led astray with the teachings. And life has become very strong. We cannot even call people to come and share with the faith which we have believed. We cannot call people to come and share with us the touch, the belief, the Lord whom we have touched, what we have seen, what we have been touched. We can't call them to come and fellowship with us. And the church is losing power of voice. We are losing strength in our own, the world, the place that have been given to us to work in. We are beggars. Praise Him. So we base the first factor of our eternal security in the book of Hebrews chapter 10. And verse 14 says that Christ has perfected with one sacrifice. So we don't need to go back and repent and repent and repent. Now God is your Father. If my child do something wrong and I put him on my lap and then I spank him. He is my child. What do I think about my child? I want him to grow to become a good adult. That's why I do what I'm doing to him or her. And the same way God has to deal with you as a father and a son. And when I grow up in the Lord with maturity, you know what happened to me? I cannot do anything and walk away. Immediately, as soon as I do something, hey, then my conscience, one of the testimony of a sure believer, that will tell me that what you've done is wrong. Go back and put it back. And I have to go and confess. And sometimes if I become very strong and stubborn, don't want to confess, then the Lord will stretch me with a punishment straightforward. I see this thing in my life. So So every time I cannot do things like the other people does, I live a different life. I cannot preach like other people do. I can't cheat like other people does. Because I've come to realize that the Bible says that it's not everyone that said, Lord, 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 shall enter into the kingdom of God. So many people will build mega churches. Many people will cast out demons. Many people will do all kinds of innumerable things. But yet they will not. You say, I know you not. And I've also understand that except those who hear his voice. He said, my sheep hear my voice. So when we talk about eternal security, there is a factor which we relate to them that brings us to the point of where we can see ourselves and check our foundations and see that things are going all right with us. I don't want anybody to deceive himself. You may call yourself I'm a believer, but do you follow the Lord? He said, my sheep hear my voice and they follow me. And what did he say? He said, I will give them eternal life. And he continued and said, they will not perish. You cannot perish. And the Bible talked to us about Romans 8 from verse 38 to 39. He said, neither death nor height. He mentioned everything. Neither life nor death, nor principality nor angels, either good angels or bad angels. Nothing, none of them can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. So the authority we carry, that witches and demons, those who torment you, they make you feel, you fear, you think, oh, they will kill you, they will do anything to you. Let me tell you, let them know wherever they are, they can hear, they have ears and voices. The kingdom of darkness can hear that anyone that are here, that they cannot touch you because you are for Christ. Neither death, nor principality. The Lord have displayed them. When he resurrected from the dead, he brought all those who are captive in death. He set the captive free. And he broke the power of death. So death hasn't got dominion over me and you. So also sin has no dominion over us. So when we are living our life and we let sin torment us, death torment us, we are making ourselves mistake. Because when you talk about sin, sin hasn't got any dominion. Why? Because what? Sin has been played over. Christ Jesus has paid for the price of sin completely. And we have now got a peace with God. We now have a relationship with God. We have now been justified freely by the grace. And so the sacrifice on the cross have paid all. So if I go back and sin, I put the Lord into shame. So immediately you sin as a child of God, don't look at yourself down, just confess it and go ahead. Because above all, the eternal life is being placed into a deadly body. So automatically sin will torment you. Sin will challenge you. As Galatians 5:17 says that the spirit war against the flesh and the flesh war against the spirit. And you will struggle to do what you're supposed to do. But with the Holy Spirit, with the testimony of the Word of God, with the testimony of the Holy Spirit, with the testimony of your conscience, with the testimony of your Christian living, according to the Word, you will triumph over them. Praise Him. We base the second factor of our eternal security in the book of Philippians chapter 1. Philippians 1:6. Now many have confused and they talk about the perseverance of the saints. The perseverance of the saints, these are teachings that make people fall into legalistic views in their life as a Christian. They think they can use their strength to do things. Now when we talk about those who have placed their life in the Lord, those who are believers, as I ask the question, can a believer lost? Can a believer lost? The believer we're talking about are those who hear the voice of the Lord. Those who follow the Lord. Those who do the will of the Father. And we now come to a point where we share a very different view here. We call it the sovereignty of God and human responsibility. What God have done in Christ Jesus, man must apply to his life. I repeat that again. What God have done in Christ, man must apply. And the application is where many problems, the monkish Christians, have been produced a lot in our world. Many has overemphasized the sovereignty of God. Many has overemphasized the application of the human responsibility. So many are preaching the conditional salvation and some are preaching unconditional salvation. I was led straight astray for the conditional teaching. And the conditional teaching will let you know that if you don't do this, you will not go to heaven. Even if you are Christian, you lose your salvation. The unconditional says that you will carry eternal life the very time you give your life to God. But you must balance something, your responsibility in the application. All falls in the atonement work of Christ. So my responsibility is to just believe. Nothing else. The word believe here places you under a place where you will be able to be touched by God. God has already provided all the privileges. As the Bible said in the book of Ephesians, that God have given us, blessed us with the spiritual blessings in heavenly places. Everything is done. All provision is made. So if I believe, automatically there is something, inheritance, that are placed inside me. And that make me love God. That make me love the word of God. That make me live my life according to the word. That make my conscience be washed and I walk in newness of life. That is what we call a believer. And how do a believer will be able to persevere to the end? Many will not be able to persevere to the end. And how do we call them? As I said to you, that they were not of us. As John, 1 John chapter 2 verse 19 says, they were not of us. They were not born again to begin with. So they drop and move off. But those who persevere to the end, it is not about your strength of perseverance. It is about the spirit perseverance. Let us see what the spirit of God is talking in the word over here. Philippians 1 says, he said, being confident of this very thing, mighty God, that he which had begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. Being confident of this very thing, that he which had begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. Who have begun a good work in you? He's talking about the Holy Spirit. The very first time you were converted, the Spirit begins his work. A good work is the conformity with the purpose of God has taught to us in Romans 8:28, that we are to be conformed to the image of Christ. So the Holy Spirit will begin from day one to start working in you. And he begins the good work. It is the same Holy Spirit who broke your unbelief and your rebellious for you to believe in God. You didn't believe in God with your own strength. If you know how to believe in God, you would have not even at all died in sin. Man have tried everything to put back with our self-righteous with everything, but the Bible says that even our righteousness is as filthy rags in the presence of the Lord. And the Bible makes it very clear to us that for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. So we didn't begin, we didn't even believe God. He prepares redemptive, he prepares salvation, he prepared his work on behalf of you, the sinner, and he also makes circumstances for you to believe. And when you believe, the Holy Spirit begins a new work in you, a good work. And the Bible says that he has begun a good work in you and he will perform it until the day of Jesus. That means he will not stop. If you don't fill yourself with the Holy Spirit as a testimony in you, that means there's something wrong with your foundation. I beg your pardon. If you don't see to yourself that way, you are deceiving yourself as a Christian. The Holy Spirit begins a good work. So even if you are able to persevere to the end on the day of redemption or the day of Jesus Christ, it is not about you. If it is about you, you could have also made your own way to heaven with your strength. Then we won't need any Jesus to come and die for us. But we couldn't. So God provided us the Spirit. And the Spirit began a good work. And He will continue to finish the work. So if somebody is with us and he couldn't persevere, he may be a man of God who is so powerful. He have got ministry, he have got everything, and he's preaching powerfully like myself. And eventually he backslide, he apostatized. When you see them, what do you say? They were not born again. They were not regenerated. They were not regenerated. They were not born again to begin with. And these people lost. But we see that the Bible talked to us about the book of Matthew, says that he that shall endure unto the end shall, the same shall be saved, in Matthew 24 verse 13. And this is the scripture where many people are abusing it. He's talking to you and I about how, what you will see about original believer. He will endure to the end because the Holy Spirit have begun a good work in him, and he will still continue until the last end. And that is where the Bible talked to us about Romans 8:16, that the Spirit led us. Those that are led by the Spirit are sons and daughters of God. So the Holy Spirit led you to God. And when he led you to God, you now become sons and daughters of God. And God adopted you. When God adopted you, you become a child of God. I've never seen when I would throw my children away and say that, no, because they've done something wrong, so I'm throwing them away. They are my children and they will be my children. The same way you, a child of God, you are always going to be a child of God. And so stop, when you do something wrong, you fear God, you fear to go to him, and stop trying to run away from the access. The Bible says that Jesus Christ have provided the peace with God and also access. Well, we go to God, we don't even have to hide any mediator. We just have to tap in Abba Father. Our mind have been broke away from the bondage. We don't carry the spirit of bondage anymore. And so the Holy Spirit began a good work, and he led you. The very time he led you is that when you stand in front of God in the doctrine of glorification, you stand in front of God, and God will say, you are my beloved daughter or son in whom I'm well pleased. That is when the Spirit of God will present you. And we see the Holy Spirit. The very first time in the creation that was mentioned, he was hovering the surface of the earth. And he did everything. And yet, it is the only place you hear the Spirit was when, in the book of Revelation, when the Spirit is presenting you to the bride. So when we talk about the Spirit, the perseverance, it is the Spirit of God in us. And every person who is a really believer have got the Spirit of God in him. Why? You become the temple of the Holy Spirit. So we were told in Ephesians 4:30, he said, do not grieve the Holy Spirit. Why? Because there is a work. In sanctification, he is dealing with you. He's transforming you. He's motivating you. And so you use your members as the instruments of righteousness. How would I use my members, my mouth, to go and curse other people or to persuade people or lie? But now I stop. I don't do that. Because I cannot do it anymore. The things I used to do, I do them no more. A great change, because why? The Spirit of God is enabling me, quickening my mortal body for me to use my instruments as an instrument, my body as an instrument of what? Of righteousness. Praise Him. So the perseverance of the saints is not anything to talk about in the way of your strength. It is about the Spirit of God in you. The Spirit of God in you. And the third factor which I would like to use in the is in the book of 2 Corinthians 5:17. Hallelujah. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. All things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. The eternal security of the believer. Can a believer lost? Can a believer lost his soul? Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. All things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. Everything has become new. When do things become new? Everything has become new in the form of your life. Because the old Adam regime is gone. And we are in the new Adam. A new life has been given to you. A new possession. So we are told in Ephesians chapter 4 verse 24. It says, put on the new man. And put off the old man. Because you are walking in newness of life. And the new life that you carry enable you to walk in a newness of understanding. A newness of doing things. A newness of talking. A newness of thinking. Everything. And so you are secured. When anybody is in that shape, the person is already secured. Eternal security of the believer. You are a new creature. Once you become a new creature is the one who have become to live a new life. And the new life, you have now been promised with a new earth, new Jerusalem. Not only to give you just a new life. So your hope is being seen ahead of you with a new heaven, a new earth, a new Jerusalem. So this thing is born and tie you around in your hope. Praise Him. So we possess eternal life. And once you possess eternal life, we speak about certain things which are likeness with the way our eternal life has been given to us. No fears. You possess it. Because the Bible tells us in John chapter 3, verse 14 to 15, what He says, as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up. That whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have eternal life. Because Adam forfeited, and he lost his life because of sin. Now eternal life is non-faith forfeited life. Otherwise it will not be called eternal life. Praise the Lord. And we are told, for God so loved the world in John 3:16, that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever, everybody knows that, whosoever believeth in Him should not perish. You will not perish, but have eternal life. And we are told in John 3:36 that he that believeth on the Son hath everlasting life, and he that believeth not on the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abideth on him. And as the Bible continued to speak about your security, He continued, John chapter 5 verse 24, verily, verily, I say unto you, he that heareth my word and believe on him that sent me hath everlasting life, and shall not come into condemnation, but pass from dead unto life. Praise Him. So He's talking about, my sheep hear my voice. Do you hear the voice of the Lord? Do you hear the voice of the Lord? The greatest thing that a Christian must ask about himself: do I live my life contrary to God, or I follow his directions? Do you follow the Lord? Do you follow him? You can assess in your own self either you follow him or who do you follow. You may not know until you assess your foundation as something you love best. It may be your talent, it may be your husband, it may be your children, it may be your job, it may be what you do. You follow that more than the Lord. How long do you spend to talk to him? How long do you hear him calling you that offer your body as a living sacrifice? How long do you hear him telling you, calling you, and giving you an assignment to do? Now go ye and preach unto the nation. Witness of me. How long do you hear his voice? How long do you feel that he's praying for you when even you can't pray? How long? If we are the one who possess eternal life, how long? How long? Now many people, no matter how they live their life, they fall back. If you are an unregenerated person, you will run back. As the Bible talk about in 2 Peter chapter 2 verse 22, it said, but it is happening unto them, according to the true proverb, the dog is turned into his own vomit again, and the soul that was washed to her wallowing in the mire. What does that mean? The dog is still the same dog. The dog didn't change. And the pig, so to speak, was just only whitewashed. He was not washed white. So once somebody is in grace, the person must always be in the grace. We don't fall back, we don't backslide. That is not the way a Christian, a believer, should live his life. If the dog would have been chained to a sheep, he would not fall back. And that is what God has done to us. We are all sinful beings, but he has regenerated you and I, and we have changed. I was a pig, now I'm a sheep. I don't do what pigs do anymore. So when I see a mud, I don't throw myself in it anymore. I run away from the mud because when I look at myself, I look white. I'm no more a dog. I don't go about and eat my vomit again. When you sin and go back and sin, you have been saved by the saving grace of the Lord, and you go back and sin, you are classified, as the Bible talked of that in that proverb, that you are like a dog. That's the proverb. I'm not insulting you, please. It's just the word of the Lord. Because we were somebody. We were nothing, and God has made us somebody. And that somebody has made you, you must see the value of that somebody is. And not to see yourself as the old nature. If you go back and do dead works, you have put yourself into the same category as the proverb says. But you are not. And Peter speaks that straightforward, that body who fall back into sin, he is like a dog and he's like a pig. They were not washed properly. They were different people, and they were not with us. So we carry eternal life, and once we carry eternal life, we can never be tortured. And as far as I'm concerned, anybody that understands eternal life must understand that you don't have to go back and be born again and again and again. There is a view which we call Arminian view, and many preachers have lied on it and preached many a times. You see some evangelists making noise and tearing the demons of hell by speaking about these things, that if you do this, you go to hell. You do this, and they speak about these things, and many people frightened. They live on the Arminian view. The Arminian view teaches that when you are converted, the very time you are converted, all your past sins have been forgiven. So the blood lies in your past sins. But God has given you another chance from the very day for you to live your life to the end. And Salvation Army was also teaching the same thing. And so these people will triumph. And if you go to their camp, a lot of people coming over and over. They sin and they come back and confess. They sin and they come back. So they born again and come back and born again and come back and born again and go back and sin and come back and born again. That is why many believers are living their life. Hold on to your eternal life. Even if you sin, does not mean you have lost it. It is still with you, but you need to confess to your father. You got something to talk to your father. Not to stand in front of him as a judge and be scared. So man still run away like the way Adam was run away. Adam, where are you? I saw you coming, I heard you coming, that's why I'm hiding myself. What have you done? You make God a judge, so we can't go in front of God. And many people even fear common place like a church, a place, a building. They fear God to the extent that they can't even come to a place of where the church members are fellowshipping. They fear. They are missing, have become something important that deals with them. They think they can't do anything about it. So they go back. The Armenian view have destroyed many Christians. And some of the people I knew, I don't see them anymore. Because I read one of the scripts who tells me that there was a guy who was in addiction. And he have got a knowledge about when he now converted. And he said, he go back and do the sin, addiction. He go back and take the drugs again. And anytime he take the drugs, he come back and then confess. And he go back and do it. And he come back and confess. And when the person who wrote the script was talking to him, he said, that is the way they have been taught. If he is confessed, he is in to heaven. But he will go back and sin again. And when they pray for him, the next time they saw him, was not a Christian anymore. He left. He said he can't. He clenched his fist and walked away. He said it's too hard. It is too hard when it comes to human perspective. In terms of salvation, so Christianity has become very difficult for people. It's too hard for me to pray. It's too hard for me to read the Bible. I can't read the Bible. You are living in the flesh. Be careful. There should not be anything too hard, because why? The Spirit of God persevere in you, quicken your mortal bodies. He will make you love God. The love of God is shed abroad in your heart. And the Spirit will train you for you to glory in tribulation. Because why? Tribulation brings perseverance, and perseverance character, and character hope. And that is the only way you can see the love of God sharing abroad in your heart. So you have the assurance of the love of God. Praise Him. So the question is, you understand and you know yourself that there's nothing that can separate us from the love of Christ. The Bible says there's nothing. Say neither death nor life, nor principality nor powers. There's nothing. This is a question, answer to the question of verse 35 of Romans chapter 8. Who can separate us from the love of Christ? Why? Because the love of Christ constrains you and I. And as Jesus says that, my sheep hear my voice, and they follow me. And my Father who gave them to me is stronger than all. Now look at you, a common mere sinner. Look at what has happened to you. You have been placed into the Lord, and the Lord say, I and my Father are one. I want to give you the strong appetite of energy that you can boot the enemy away from your home. Simple, because this is a principle. When the knowledge of the truth is declared, God is committed to deliver. I and my Father are one. So you are being embraced by the Lord Jesus Christ, and His Father now come and put His hand across. So he continues to say, nobody can pluck my sheep away from my Father. So the Lord is now with you, and the Father has put his hand across the Son whom he loved. He has embraced him. That is where he's sitting on the right hand side of the Father. The Father has put his hand around him, and you are inside him. Imagine who can ever break the hands except the enemy. If you want to break into you, the enemy have to break into the hand of God, losing the hand of the mighty God. Who can lose the hand of God? You sit down in fear. Anybody who is watching this message, you have not been born to be fear of anything, except you don't know the truth. It is written that you have been born with boldness and confidence to live your life as a Christian, and you will never perish. Neither death, nor life, nor height, nor heaven, nor hell, nor death. Nothing can stop you being a Christian. And I want you to look through yourself and see your foundations. If you are not following the Lord Jesus Christ, his word is his word. He can't change his word. He said, they follow me. Eternal security are for those who follow him. Not for those who just come to church, or who have joined a church, or who have just baptized. It's for those who follow the Lord. And the question is, do you follow him? Do you hear his voice? Do you hear his voice? Do you live your life up to him? Have you offered your body as a living sacrifice to him? He dwells in you. He doesn't want you to do any mistakes anymore. He wants to fight your enemies for you. He said, you don't have any more enemies. Your enemy hunger, feed him. If your enemy is thirsty, give him something to drink. Why? Vengeance is mine, I will repay. You got nothing to do. Your responsibility is to just offer yourself as a sacrifice. That is what the word believe is. Believe is not just by only mouth. And people confess with their mouth, they think they have eternal life. That's not what eternal security means. It means when you offer your whole burnt offering, your whole self as a burnt offering, everything, not nothing left. Hallelujah. I want you to look to yourself and talk to him. How you feel now today about this message? Pray unto him right now. It is the moment that you can say to the Lord, Lord, I offered myself to you, and I've heard what has been said to me, and my life is going to change for good. Today, I am in your hands. I am in your presence. Take control of me. Talk to him. Talk to him. The Lord opened a great door. You have set up a peace with you and God. And you have a right to talk to him as a father. Not a judge. A father. You have not been talking to him for quite a long time. Take opportunity. Take advantage and talk to him. He's every time open up to you to talk to you. But you don't. We spend time on the telephone. We spend time on unnecessary things. We're thinking we are doing his work, but we don't talk to him. How many times do we pray to him? How long do we talk to him? When even we come to church and spend about 2-3 hours, we cry. We can spend the rest of the time in many other things. Talk to him. He has given you your power, authority, privileges, provisions. You rule the whole world because you carry eternal life. And nothing shall by all means hurt you. He has promised that he will deliver you from the snare of the fowler and from the noisome pestilence. He will deliver you from all. Whatever the enemy is doing is not what you are looking for, because it has been taken care of because of your eternal inheritance. Talk to him. Talk to him. The dead cannot praise God except the living. He demands your living sacrifice. And it is ruled the living can praise the Lord. talk to him. Transform and renew your mind tonight, because this is the only chance you, God. Your soul lies in two oppositions. There's no any other time like today. When today pass away, tomorrow will be a different time, and you know you may not meet today anymore. You will say, oh, I had opportunity, I should have, but it is already passed. Don't let today pass. Enjoy today as it is the end of your life, and take all the advantages and privileges. Spend time with him. Talk to him. You will never have this opportunity. Talk to him. It is your time. It is your moment of truth. He is listening to you. Don't let the noise of your ears, your mind, distract you that God is not listening. He is listening to you. He is in you. Even if you are not opening your mouth, he is in you. He knows what your mind is saying. Talk to him. Praise the Lord. In Jesus' name, let us pray. Father, we thank you for this opportunity and this time which you have given to us. Lord, your children are under the sound of my voice, Father. Some of them have got so many different questions in their mind concerning the fundamental question of their existence. Lord, broke into the chambers of their mind and explain to them how the eternal security of their life is, that their faith will stand according to their living, that they will see the witnesses in them, that wherever they walk, they will be the light, they will be the salt, they will be what you have made them to be, to present themselves to people that this is God incarnation, that they look like Jesus, they think like Jesus, they use their body as the instrument of righteousness, Father, for you, that their heart desire will fall in love with you. Lord, show them the real believer which you ask for. And today, let them hear your voice as they are your sheep. And let them know that they will follow you. It is not about their strength. It's not about their might. It is about your spirit. Let your spirit take control of each and everyone here. That they will begin to feel a different thing. They will begin to understand what God has given to them. No man can take. No man can separate them. No man can put asunder the love of Christ between them. Hallelujah. This is our prayer in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And the people of God say, Amen.
The divine power, I believe in the Savior you have given me. I believe in the one who has said to lead me. I believe in the help. I believe in the promises that I will be like you. I believe. I walk in that trust, not just my mouth. I believe. I walk. Believe is a word which is there. Do it. You just don't say, I believe, and you sit down. It doesn't stay. The word believe doesn't stay one place. The word believe move. So faith move. Faith move. How can faith move? Faith cannot move without diligence. So you see over there, faith plus diligence. Diligence is what you call effort. The effort of your faith is the move of your faith. Many people's faith are crippled. They are spiritually disabled. They need to be delivered. Their faith are crushing. Their faith are still sleeping. Their faith are still dead. They have the crucified Christ still in the tomb, not risen yet. If your faith are risen, then you will walk. And that walking is what we call diligence. A faith without diligence is impotent. You can't grow. You can be in a church for 200 years. And you brag and say, I know. You know all the Bible, but without diligence to your faith, you go nowhere. Diligence is the effort. You must want to do something before you can do it. If you don't want to be a Christian, don't want to walk as a Christian, you don't want to follow Jesus, you won't follow him. Some people can come to you and say, Lord, what shall we do that we can follow you? I want to follow you. Is that the asking question? God said, when your plan is done, give that the world that you are living in, the world, the Bible world, that you have picked up and taught these are precious things. Throw them away, just give them. Give them out to the poor, to anyone, and come and follow me. Because I have no hopes. I don't have a dwelling in this world. My dwelling to the Father is in heaven. And that is why I told you there are many mansions, John 14, verse 2. There are many mansions in my Father's house. I go to prepare a place for you. People who are serious, they come to Christ, they want to have a house here. They want to have a wife, they want to have a car. They're talking about earthly issues. That is not faith. Your faith is still dead, because the whole world is dead in the sight of God. I want to challenge you. Are you living a Christian? Talk to me. My name is Rev.Yaw Sarpong, and I want to make sure what we do in this ministry is to set people up in a relationship with God, knowing God. That is our assignment in this ministry, the winning grace of faith evangelical ministry. You know, we are not here to pass people, to just sit down and become like a sardine, pack you in a tin and seal it nicely, and then selling you, and then you dusting it nicely because of what? Coming to church. No. The purpose of setting up a ministry and church is to raise people in relationship to God, that they may know him, the only true God, and the Son whom he has sent. Faith, diligence. Two things work together. The reason why people give up, they cannot be Bible, they cannot do anything in church, is because they don't have diligence, they don't have effort. That's why they will say that faith without works, your works. He put diligence as works. The Apostle Paul also talked about faith. All these two people, they mean the same. A faith without works is impotent. You cannot bring your work along as your faith, as people do. They just give money to the poor, they give glory to salvation, they do all this. These are good commendable things, but they alone cannot work. But you need to believe in Christ Jesus.
Step by step, I'm walking this road. Never thought I'd make it this far. When I think about the mercy you've shown me, I must confess, you can use anything. Indeed, I'm walking step. If it had not been side. When the enemy came in for my life, now I know he would have destroyed me, leaving me to die in my sin and shame. You never left
Jesus, step by step, walk with me.